Eddie Chavez. Ruben Nava. And Jesse Romero. Jesus 911.
Jesus 911, Virgin Most Powerful Radio, 2-Man Car. Jesse Romero, Ruben Nava with you today. Two retired cops giving you some intel, some briefing for your war bag so that you can go out and evangelize. Jesse, good morning.
Reporting for duty, sir.
Right.
Hey, Ruben, we got... I like to talk to guys that are fired up for Jesus, fired up for the Catholic faith, and we got two guys today, just laymen. And that's what's going to save the church, is just laymen getting involved, reconnecting with their faith,
yes,
falling in love with Christ, falling in love with the church, pursuing a life of holiness. This is what the church needs. We need this in spades.
I agree completely, Jess. And this young man, I know that we've communicated back and forth on email, and it's great to know that there's a lot of first responders all over the country that are listening to us. And man, I wish we had a program like this when not to puff ourselves up, but I wish we had a program like this when we were young cops, you know. So,
you're right. To encourage us, I mean, we were just kind of grinding it out, you know, trying to find ourselves in the midst of the swamp of, you know, just a very secular environment.
That's right.
But yeah, you know, we're trying to provide this for all these young first responders out there to give them something to listen to, so they can go to 10-8 every day and say, you know what, man, I'm going to serve Jesus Christ, you know, day in and day out, in season and out of season.
That's right. Wear it on your sleeve. Don't be ashamed of who you are. Be proud of being a Catholic, man. We're on the A team. We're on the varsity.
That's right.
Right?
Hey, we've got an officer. In fact, he's active law enforcement. His name is Rick. He's a cop from Utah, and I'm pretty sure we have him on the line. Rick, are you on?
I'm here, Jesse.
Hey.
Good morning, Rick.
Good morning. Good morning, Rick. We met. I went out to Utah and stuff, and I met him at a parish conference and stuff, and I was very impressed with him. And I've been telling him I need to get you on the show. And as it is, I think he listens to the show. He listens to the podcast whenever he can. So, Rick, as a young man, you sense that. Well, you were born in Utah, so you were born in pretty much Mormon country, but you sensed that you were meant for greatness. I remember when I was talking to you, you sensed that you were not meant for mediocrity, but for greatness. You know, in Catholicism, we call this magnanimous, and that means that's the Latin word, which means greatness of soul. Tell us a little bit about, did you grow up Mormon? Did you grow up unchurched? And when did you start realizing, man, I was made for something bigger than this?
Yeah. First, just thanks for having me on. I actually, you know, growing up as a kid, I always thought I was meant to do something big and special and important. You know, I think every kid kind of has that in their life. But as I continued to grow, I always just continued to have that urge. You know, I didn't know, man, am I gonna act in movies? Am I gonna write a cool book? Am I gonna do something really special and save someone's life? I mean, I've always been searching for that my whole life, and I always just feel like I'm here for something. Never knew what it was. Searched for it in my career, searched for it in my personal life, just all the different areas of my life. And I've kind of, as I've come into my faith a couple years ago, realized it's. I don't think it's something for this world. It's for something for the kingdom of God, and to do God's work. And that's kind of this urge I've always been feeling. So yeah, I grew up with one brother. My father was a non-active Mormon, and my mother was a non-active Catholic, and they're both still non-active in their faith. So they made the mutual decision for me and my brother to just decide what we wanted to be when we grew up, and didn't baptize us in any faith or take us really to church services or anything like that. So
Rick, what did you think growing up as a young man, basically unchurched? What did you think about God, about the supernatural, about heaven, about hell? Did you ever think about those things as you're growing up, or you just kind of put them aside because you didn't grow up in a church community?
No, I always had a general belief in God and Jesus Christ. I didn't know that was the extent of it. I believed in their existence. I knew little about them, and I had no relationship really with God. You know, I probably prayed here and there occasionally, maybe when I needed something. But I had a Bible that collected dust on the shelf. I never really read it. I grew up, most of my friends growing up were Mormon. So I went to several of their church services growing up, just mostly to hang out and see my buddies. You know, I wasn't anything of searching out my faith at any real time, sincerely. I didn't have that relationship, but I always did believe in a God. That never really came into question, really.
So you did have, growing up in Utah, you had Mormon, and I think you also told me that you had Baptist influence as you were growing up. Did you, was any one of those compelling to you, or were you just trying to pass time and meet friends?
Yeah, no, not really. You know, I'm a fellow martial artist like you, Jesse, or was anyways. I grew up doing martial arts throughout my teen years and growing up. My dad got me into it, and, one of the guys there I became really good friends with there for a few years. Was probably my best friend for that period of time. You know, he was a born-again Christian. His dad was a pastor of a little startup church that they did. You know, they rented some daycare space on Sundays for an hour for him to gather with a dozen people or so. And so I went a few times to that. You know, it never really rang with me. Honestly, it was quite uncomfortable. I don't know why. Now looking back, the lack of reverence. I mean, in their mind, they have their reverence, you know, and that's the way that they experience and worship God is, you know, by the singing, the guitaring, and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, I'm not trying to dog on them for how they you know, what they think is mm-hmm. right in their mind. But yeah, I never felt comfortable there.
Rick, wasn't there? Didn't you experience a hard sell with the Mormons? I mean, out in Utah. They're pretty much all over the country. Wasn't it a hard sell? I mean, like every single week, knocking at your door. Hey, Rick, come on over here. Let's go to services.
You know, I always got. You know, I grew up pretty lucky with not too pushy of neighbors. You know, they always welcomed me to go with them. It was never something that they pushed on me too hard. So I did go a lot. You know, and you know they call it their sacrament meetings. For what they believe is celebrating the sacrament. Lots of testimony meetings. You know, I witnessed a lot of people give their testimonies of, a lot of them were very sincere and very emotional. And, you know, so I give them credit, and I'm not, you know, I respect their sincerity and their hearts, but no testimonies from the Mormon faith ever rang true to me, ever really struck me as truth, as, wow, I got to look into this. And it just never did.
Rick,
growing up, that's kind of where it was.
Rick, this is Ruben. You're that small percentage of people that actually find their faith when they're not given any faith as a child. I've heard, in fact, early on, I was in a relationship with a non-Catholic, actually, she was Jewish. So when she said, "Well, we could just raise our kids with no faith and let them choose when they get older," and I thought, that's not going to work, you know, because they're going to choose nothing. But you're the exception that did choose something. You made the right choice, and so I commend you for that. But that's generally not how it happens. So
exactly.
It's good to have you on board, and so go on with your story. I find this fascinating and interesting.
Yeah, you were attracted to Catholicism in the midst of all this, right? I mean, did you ever think about the Catholic faith?
Yeah, so, you know, one other thing I wanted to say was, you know, growing up, even as a young adult, I always kind of thought it was a good thing my parents didn't make me grow up in one of their faiths. But looking back in hindsight now, I feel like I was robbed 28 years of my life of a relationship with God. Even if they decided to raise me Mormon, it still would have been a relationship with God, even if it wasn't, as I see it now, the fullness of truth and you know, correct theology and everything. You know, even if it's not the Catholic faith, I think it's wrong, and I feel horrible for children who grow up with parents who don't talk to them about God, who don't or even say, God doesn't believe, or I don't believe in God. And so, you know, looking at it now, I realize, I wish that my parents didn't make that mistake, but, you know, here I am. So, but yeah, I did go to a few midnight Christmas Eve Catholic masses with my grandmother. She wasn't too active Catholic. It was my mother's mom. But, you know, there were a couple of those that I did attend, and I loved it. And, you know, I knew little about the Catholic faith. You know, I knew people confess sins to priests and about what they show in Hollywood movies, and that was the extent of my knowledge of the Catholic faith. But whenever I did go to those, I loved the reverence. I loved, you know, the standing, the kneeling. It was very different in those regards to some other church services I've been to. I just liked the way the liturgy was celebrated. I didn't understand the Mass or anything about it. I just sat there and I just attended and I was there. And I always told myself in the back of my mind, you know, the day I decide to take my faith seriously, I think I'm going to seek the Catholic Church. I always kind of just felt that in my mind. I don't know why, you know, they seem shallow that, oh, you just chose the church you were comfortable with. Maybe. I don't, you know, but at the time, that's just something I always told myself. I didn't have a doubt that I was ever going to do that, but I just decided, you know, if I ever do, I think I will seek the Catholic Church.
All right, Rick. Hey, that's we're coming to the close of our first segment. You're listening to a young officer from Utah by the name of Rick. He's telling us his journey into the Catholic faith and amidst the state of Mormons. But stay with us. We're going to hear the rest of his story when we come back.
This is Terry Barber reminding you there's a women's conference coming up September 7th, 2019 at the Sacred Heart Chapel. Mary Danielle Barber will be speaking along with Barbara Nicolosi. They're going to be talking about true femininity. Be who you are. This is going to be for your daughters, your mothers. Every woman should be at this conference. And the way to do it is go to virginmostpowerfulradio.org or call 877-526-2151.
Buying or selling your home or your business property? This is Terry Barber. Real Estate for Life underwrites the Terry and Jesse Show, and they can connect you to one of 900 pro-life real estate agents around the world. And when they receive their referral fee, they will give 80% of it to a pro-life organization. Wow, that's 80%. RealEstateForLife.org, 877-LIFE-US1.
Now, back to Jesus 911. If this call is not an emergency, dial 888-526-2151.
Jesus 911, we're iron sharpens iron and one man sharpens another. And we have a young man that's giving us some sharpening by the name of Rick from Utah. Jess, you want to pick up
Rick,
the next question?
Just... You entered law enforcement at the ripe old age of 21. You got married. That didn't work out so well. So now you're 22 years old. You're a young cop who's divorced. You're dealing probably with a high-stress job, probably a little bit depressed. And all of a sudden, in this probably this dark time in your life, you meet your soulmate, your true soulmate. Her name's Katie. And both of you kind of grew into your Catholic faith. And that kind of impelled you to become a Catholic and come into the church entirely through RCIA. So can you walk us through that?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll try to keep it pretty succinct. I got into the academy at the age of 20, got a job when I was 21, right there in the heart of 2009 when the economy wasn't too good. So it was very stressful. You know, it was stressful applying when I got hired. It was very stressful to keep the job. I married very young. I was 21. She was 19. It didn't work out. I made a lot of mistakes. I got too flirtatious when I was only dating her before we got engaged and married, had a little side fling with a cadet, and I carried that lie a long time and didn't tell her about it until after we were married. And there were a lot of problems on both sides, but that was a big thing. And the relationship or the marriage didn't work out. After 9 months, we split. And so here I am at 22 years old. And the following 6 months of my life were my lowest. I started drinking alcohol every weekend, having parties with friends, and I slept with half a dozen women. I spent many nights on my bedroom floor, just still drunk after a party, sobbing about my life, where it was at, where it was going. I felt ashamed of who I was. I broke a lifelong promise to myself that I could never do something like that, especially, you know, finding out, you know, my parents split, and I know there was infidelity involved in that. And so it was something that I firsthand was a victim of that. And so, you know, when I looked in the mirror, you know, I saw a failure. You know, I wasn't good at sports. You know, I had a smaller frame. I didn't grow up with many skills and hobbies. So my character was the best thing I had going for me. And now I'm a 22-year-old cliche divorced cop. And I feel like my character was destroyed. But, you know, I met Katie, my wife. You know, she grew up Catholic. Her father and two sisters kind of fell away from the church, don't really go anymore. But her and her mom continued to go, and Katie continued to go, you know, quite lukewarm in her faith, but she did continue to go into Mass through her college years, and praise God, long enough to meet me. So, you know, we met, and we didn't really get into our, you know, faith, or she didn't go to Mass or anything with me until we were pregnant with our second child a couple years ago. And she just mentioned that, hey, you know, when our kids, you know, after our second child's born, I would like to get them baptized, and I would like to take them to Mass. And I just, you know, I had no problem with that. I thought it was a good thing. I said, sure, that's fine. And she said, well, hey, if you want to be Catholic, I think you got to go through some classes or something as an adult. Do you want to do that? And I said, sure, you know. And we went to our local parish the following weekend and talked to the RCIA director right after Mass. And he said, hey, yeah, Monday RCIA actually starts. So, I mean, it just
ironic,
kind of
yeah.
Fell right perfectly into place. And from the first day of RCIA, I was hooked. I was a sponge. I soaked in everything. I read everything I could get my hands on. And to this day, that's how I still am.
Good. So it wasn't by no coincidence that that RCIA class was starting. It was meant for you, Rick. And, you know, so on the job, I know that it's a macho type, you know, job, guys that with a lot of A personalities. And do you find it difficult to let people know where you're coming from, what you stand for, your ideals, your faith, or do you get a chance to bring that up?
You know, in the beginning, I think I was a little bit, you know, it's kind of, especially here, even with, you know, my fellow Mormon coworkers, you know, a lot of them, most of them don't wear their faith on their sleeve. You know, they'll say they're Mormon if you ask them. But I mean, you guys know the culture and kind of climate in law enforcement. You know, you're around bad people. You know, it's a male dominant field. You know, there's swearing, there's inappropriate jokes, and they leave all that and embrace all that. And, you know, so you're still immersed in that. And you know, I I'd be lying if I say I don't still participate in some foul language, inappropriate jokes from time to time. It's almost impossible to stay away from it in this field. But, but you know,
brutally honest.
No, I mean, yeah, yeah, no, and you know, today, no, at my desk, I got a statue of Mary and a crucifix, and I got the liturgical calendar hanging up. No, my fellow coworkers definitely know I'm a Catholic. So.
What does the captain say about that?
You know, I don't think they say a word, because I think in today's climate, you try to trip on someone's religion too much in the work field. You know, they haven't said anything. You know, I don't get too crazy. It's just a couple little statues, yeah. You know, underneath my my monitor, and but yeah, they know they're fine with it.
And by the way, how old are you now?
I'm 31.
31. Okay, so you've been on the job 10 years then. Okay, yep. So you said you have a desk, so I take it you're inside, you're working DB or something, Detective Bureau?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. Suit and tie? Coat and tie, or yeah. You know, shirt and tie?
A lot of that, yep.
Yeah,
yep.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you know what? That's you probably have a good schedule, so you're able to get to Mass on Sunday with your wife and family, so that plays into it. It's huge, because a lot of guys working patrol, you know, with the shifts on weekends and nights and early morning shifts, it could be strenuous on trying to get to Mass. But the
For
Catholic
sure.
Church, you know, we have Mass. You can go Saturday night. You can go. There's tons of Masses on Sunday. So
every hour on the hour somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Hey, that, go ahead, Jess.
Rick. So would you consider now, I mean, you're immersed in the Catholic faith at this point, you're 31, you're in a strong Catholic marriage. Do you see the Christian life now more and more so than before as a battle? And do you feel moments of, you know, do you feel these moments every now and then of abandonment or weakness? And then you feel these high points, like these mountaintop experiences, because we all go through that, these highs and lows. So my question is, how do you, as a Catholic man, try to fortify your faith and discipline yourself so that you stay on an even keel, so that you don't, you know, again, just fall into these real low points where you feel like, man, I don't feel like praying. I don't feel the presence of God. I feel abandoned. What's your spiritual schedule to keep you, on that narrow path?
Yeah, for sure. No, being a devout Catholic is by far the hardest thing I've ever done in my entire life. It is a battle. It's not easy. You know, a lot of people think, oh, you're Christian, so, you know, you're set. You think you're perfect. No, it's the hardest thing I've ever done. But, you know, I do have high ups. I have low downs. You know, I've come to understand the person's faith in God isn't always about the butterflies we all felt at our baptism or another special day. You know, God calls us to grow into deeper relationships beyond those human feelings,
right?
Because those can come and go. You know, one must be allowed to undergo trials and temptations. So, you know, our fallen yet redeemed lives here on earth are a spiritual battle. I've lost many battles, but praise God for confession. But, you know, no, I visit, luckily with the schedule I have now, I'm able to scarf my lunch real quick, and I dip into the Adoration Chapel during my work week.
Wow.
At lunchtime.
That's awesome.
For some prayer. I pray a rosary every day, and I've recently picked up praying the Liturgy of the Hours for a very just kind of grounded, I'm a man of routine, so it's definitely helps me in that way as well. And then I help out with RCIA now at my church. You know, I feel like being a newer convert, and I like talking about my faith, so that's the best place to do it, because people there actually want to hear about it.
Hey, Rick, when I came back to my faith, I started taking it serious. I was hit with this. I really realized how my mortality is right at the forefront, and you know, if we meditate on you know, on that last day of our life often enough, that's going to be enough. It could be enough to keep us away from sin. And did that enter into your mind once you realized what the faith was all about? Then you realized, man, if I die in mortal sin, man, I'm going to lose everything. Does, you know, especially in the job that we have.
Yeah, absolutely. I do my best to not go to work in this job in that state. You know, I read a book called The Dogma of Hell by Father Shoup, a Jesuit priest. He wrote it
ten books ago,
but
it's a red book, yeah, right?
it's very good. It's very good. It kind of scares you straight, but you know, I long to see Christ's face upon my death, but it terrifies me, because I just hope that I'm worthy enough, at that moment, to go with him. So,
hey, Rick, any last thoughts you want to make, before you go 10-8?
Just what you have him talk about some miracles that he might.
Yeah. Share about a miracle or two before we wrap it up here.
Yeah, no, I've been praying in the chapel, like I said, I go to. I've been asking God if I'm doing the right thing, to give me an answer, that I'm living according to His will. It's a heavy burden to kind of be the main pole of the tent, holding up the faith of my family. And so, I was in praying the rosary one day, and this woman came in and started praying her rosary too. And I finished pretty quick because I had already been in there a minute, and she finished at the same time. So I thought that's kind of weird. You know, she didn't have time to pray one decade, but I sat down and this woman walks over to me and she hands me a small wooden cross and she just points up at the crucifix and she says through her thick accent, "He says that he loves you." And she smiled at me and she left and she walked out. I haven't seen her before. I hadn't seen her since. You know, I thought for a while it was just a kind gesture by a woman. But I've come to accept and believe that that was God using that woman to just let me know He loves me. I'm doing His will. I'm okay. You know, so that wooden cross hangs next to my bed ever since that day happened. So, and I just want to say to people, we all experience those dry spells. I've had moments where I don't even feel like going to Mass. I don't feel like praying. It's hard. You don't feel God. You don't hear God. But He's there. The problem's ours, not His. But, you know, Teresa of Avila, I believe it was, or Mother Teresa, one of the two, she, you know, decades of dry spells that she experienced. All the saints went through that. If you read and study any of their lives, they all felt those. So it's not God abandoning us.
Right.
It's us needing to battle through that and grow that deeper relationship.
That's right. We're not given consolation all the time. So that's awesome. Hey, Rick, thanks for joining us. Thanks for being a faithful listener and being a solid Catholic. And remember, if you stay ready, you don't have to get ready. Yeah. Yes?
That's right. Thank you very much, guys.
All right. Go 10-8, brother. God bless you. Be safe.
All right.
You're listening to the Jesus 911 Muscular Christianity. You got another guest that's going to give us a rip-roaring Bible study. Don't change that dial.
This is Terry Barber reminding you, there's a women's conference coming up September 7th, 2019 at the Sacred Heart Chapel. Mary Danielle Barber will be speaking along with Barbara Nicolosi. They're going to be talking about true femininity, be who you are. This is going to be for your daughters, your mothers. Every woman should be at this conference. And the way to do it is go to virginmostpowerfulradio.org or call 877-526-2151.
Buying or selling your home or your business property? This is Terry Barber. Real Estate for Life underwrites the Terry and Jesse Show, and they can connect you to one of 900 pro-life real estate agents around the world. And when they receive their referral fee, they will give 80% of it to a pro-life organization. Wow! That's 80%! RealEstateForLife.org, 877-LIFE-US1.
Now, back to Jesus 911. If this call is not an emergency, dial 888-526-2151.
Jesus 911, two-man car. No cross, no crown, no pain, no gain, and no guts, and no glory. It's about sacrifice and dying to ourselves, dying to our will, and serving God's will. Jess, we have another guest.
Yeah, we got another ride along in this two-man car, this black and white for Jesus that's heaven-bound. We got a friend by the name of Mike McDonald. Mike, are you on the line?
I sure am. Thanks, Jesse.
Okay, Mike, you're on with my partner, Ruben Navas, two-man. This is a two-man squad car. We call it Jesus 911.
Good morning, Mike.
Let me tell you a little bit about Mike.
Good morning.
Before we get into it. I met Mike a couple of weeks ago. He just moved out here to Phoenix, Arizona from Minnesota. And we were talking about people that we knew. He knows Jeff Cavins, and so do I do. So Mike is immersed in Scripture as well as myself. I love to meet Catholic men that are Bible junkies. So Mike sat there. We went to have a cup of coffee at Denny's right after a men's Bible study. And Mike sat there with a bunch of guys, and he goes, "Hey, I want to share something with you." And he shared several Old Testament books where he goes through chapter 9. And the way chapter 9 has the message for Catholic men. I sat there drinking my coffee at Denny's listening to Mike McDonald, and I was saying, whoa, I got to put this guy on my radio show so he can share what he just shared with me over a cup of coffee at Denny's so he can share this with a wider audience. So, Mike, it's all yours. What did you share with a couple of men the other night here in Phoenix, Arizona, about chapter 9 of several Old Testament books? Go ahead. Ramp it up, Mike.
Sure. Back in 2014, where we lived in Minnesota, our archdiocese was experiencing a lot of trouble, and it looked like the whole diocese was imploding. The archbishop was even in trouble from top to bottom. There was scandal and concern. I worked in a Catholic church as an administrator, and folks were finding their way to me every day, many times a day, saying, "What is going on in the church? What is happening? Is anything left that's real? You know, who is true?" They were fractured over the scandals and the lack of fidelity that they could see all around them. And I walked around like I had a dagger in my chest. I was so discouraged. And I knew many, many folks who had been caught up in these scandals and infidelities on the inside of the church. And I decided, you know, I need to bring this before the Lord because I need to know what to do, how to help folks, and I need to balance my life out and understand what I'm supposed to do as a Christian Catholic man. So I went to prayer, and uncharacteristically, some things began to happen. I don't get these things from God, like, you know, words and messages very often, really. I get nudged by the Holy Spirit, I guess, like everybody should. But I decided to leave my office for a break, and I went before the tabernacle in the church. And I said, "Lord, what am I supposed to do? What can I do to help these folks? How do I understand what's going on in your church?" And this thing popped into my head, "Read the nines." And I thought, "Oh my gosh, what is going on? What does that mean?" And I just picked up my Bible and my stuff and I went back to my office. End of the day, I go before the tabernacle again and ask the Lord again the same thing. "How can I understand all this? How can I help others understand it? Read the nines." And I thought, I'm going nuts. I mean, this is not cool. So I go home that night, about 11 o'clock at night, everything's quiet. I sit in a rocking chair, pull out my Bible, say, Lord, I need you to break through here. And it comes again, read the nines. I folded up my book. I go upstairs to bed. I'm thinking, you know, maybe I need help. I don't know. So the next day, in the middle of the morning, I go before the tabernacle again. Say, Lord, I'm going to stay here until I hear something I understand. What is going on? I prayed again, and it said, read the nines. I said, okay, what do you mean? And then all of a sudden, boom, this memory from Bible study of the book of Ezra came to mind, where Ezra, after the evening offering, gathers folks together, and he is dismayed because of the infidelity and the sin of the people around him. And remember, the people that came back to Israel when they returned to rebuild the temple with Ezra were a hodgepodge of folks religiously now. They had been unfaithful. They probably had Canaanite and Persian religions mixed into their spirituality. They had relationships with pagans. They had married pagans. Things were messed up. And Ezra saw it clearly after that sacrifice, and he got up and he said, Oh Lord, my God, this is chapter 9, I am ashamed and I blush to lift my face to thee, my God, for our iniquities have risen higher than our heads, and our guilt has mounted up to the heavens. And he basically recounts the history of the people with God, God rescuing them, their infidelity, and now this small group have come back together, and they have to be committed to God. He confesses the sins of the nation to God, asking him to renew and save the remnant of his people. I'm thinking, oh, wow, cool. And then another one came to mind, Nehemiah chapter 9, a similar situation where the people have been added to now. Many years after Ezra, another group show up with Nehemiah to rebuild the walls of the city with the permission of the emperor. And in the same way, this prayer of Ezra had grown from just him and his group to a leader of six leaders of the nation who came before the Lord, and they gathered folks to themselves. They stood and they confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. Chapter 9, Nehemiah. The same thing. They honestly assessed that they were in rebellion to God, that they have turned their back to his law. They acted presumptuously and did not obey. And
Mike, let me just jump in. Right now, Catholics that are trying to live their faith, we do feel like Ezra and Nehemiah right now. So we're walking in their shoes. Everything that you're saying right now, somebody who's trying to live in fidelity to the church, we kind of could empathize with the way they felt. Go ahead, continue.
Absolutely, yeah.
One of the common things between the Ezra prayer and the Nehemiah event is that they, one, recognize that God is righteous in his judgment for their sins. That God is good. He has been lavishing loving kindness on them, but they turn their back on him. And that God really wants to rescue the people. So I backed up. Now the time was just flowing before the Lord in front of the tabernacle, and all of a sudden Deuteronomy 9 comes to mind, where Moses recounts how the people had sinned, and he, in verse 25, he says, So I lay prostrate before the Lord 40 days and 40 nights, because the Lord said he would destroy you. And I prayed to the Lord, O Lord, destroy not the people, not thy people and thy heritage, which thou hast redeemed through thy greatness and brought out of Egypt. And he went on that he stood in that gap in the wall that was a threat to the people of God. and he interceded for them. Now, obviously, when Moses did that, he wasn't changing God's mind. He was becoming God's man in prayer. And he was able to then fill that breach in the wall of the people of God and began to move forward to help them become God's own possession. So I began to understand then that, okay, so Lord, you're with these strange nines, you're calling us to intercede, confess the sins of our own people, even if we never did any of these things, were to stand with them and for them. So all of a sudden, Isaiah 9 and Jeremiah 9 came to mind, where God says he's aware of the rebellion and he will deal with it. Even if the people don't return to them, he will deal with them. It says in Jeremiah 9, verse 13, because they have forsaken my law, which I set before them, and not obeyed my voice or walked in accord with it, they have stubbornly followed their own hearts and have gone after the Baals and as their fathers taught them. So he's warning that in this infidelity to God, there is idolatry. And idolatry, you know, can be greed, it can be sexual sin and addiction, and it can also be false religion. And these things seem to be the threads of a lot of this controversy that we deal with inside the church.
Absolutely. Right now, what we're dealing with in the church is sexual idolatry, financial idolatry, and then there's also, Satanism within the ranks of some of the clergy. So you nailed it.
Exactly.
You hit it right in the head. Mike, go ahead.
In Hosea 9 and Amos 9, they both warn about God's great displeasure with spiritual harlotry and the sexual depravity and other depravities and just plain evil. When these were coming to me, my heart was just bleeding. This other thing came, and I don't read the book of Ezekiel a whole lot. I just haven't had enough time, and I've read it. But so this one really came to me out of the blue. Ezekiel chapter 9, where the prophet...
Mike, I hear the music. We're going to have to pick this up in the next segment, so just stand by. This is good stuff here.
Will do.
Hold that thought.
Thanks.
Yep.
You're listening to Jesus 911. We'll be right back with our special guest.
This is Terry Barber reminding you, there's a women's conference coming up September 7th, 2019 at the Sacred Heart Chapel. Mary Danielle Barber will be speaking along with Barbara Nicolosi. They're going to be talking about true femininity, be who you are. This is going to be for your daughters, your mothers. Every woman should be at this conference. And the way to do it is go to virginmostpowerfulradio.org or call 877-526-2151.
Buying or selling your home or your business property? This is Terry Barber. Real Estate for Life underwrites the Terry and Jesse Show, and they can connect you to one of 900 pro-life real estate agents around the world. And when they receive their referral fee, they will give 80% of it to a pro-life organization. Wow! That's 80%! RealEstateForLife.org, 877-LIFE-US1.
Now, back to Jesus 911. If this call is not an emergency, dial 888-526-2151.
Jesus 911, Virgin Most Powerful Radio. We have a two-man car and a ride-along today with a special guest, Mike. He's given us a little Bible study, and I'm finding this fascinating because any Catholic who is up on their faith and is aware of what's going on in the news, and they know that the church is in trouble. And what Mike's explaining to us is that this you could find the same thing happening in ancient Israel. And he's going over the verses from chapter 9s of various books of the Old Testament. Go ahead, Mike.
Mike, get it.
Yes, sir.
Continue.
Okay, so when I began to realize these words from God in the Old Testament, warning of apostasy, false religion, idolatry, and how the people were unfaithful, and God was committed to correct it by judgment or whatever, the burden on me became extremely heavy. And I thought, you know, Lord, why is my heart so heavy? I feel like I'm walking around with a dagger in my chest. And boom, Ezekiel 9 came to my mind. And Ezekiel's not a book that I went to a lot over the years, but so this came kind of out of the blue. But going into it, I knew that what I was reading was that God was aware of what was going on. God was committed to doing something about it, and I needed to understand that context. And in Hebrews chapter 3 and 4, it warns the New Testament church to avoid the infidelity of Israel's unbelief and disobedience.
Wow.
And it's grave to see so much of our church struggling with these problems. But it's not unexpected. I mean, you look at 2 Peter 2, the book of Jude, and you'll see warnings right out of the Old Testament. Don't get suckered into these sins, and they name the big criminals in the Old Testament. So there's a precedent for the church, and you know, any warning to the New Testament church is a warning to us because we are
right.
It.
That's right.
So Ezekiel opens up this chapter with these with this angelic SWAT team showing up in Jerusalem, and the prophet sees this. There's a bunch of them that are armed heavily, and then there's one dressed in white with a writer's kit, a scribe's kit. And the direction to those angelic beings is to be ready to execute judgment. But the guy in white with the pen is to go through the city and find those whose hearts are grieving and lamenting over the abominations in Jerusalem.
So there's a remnant. There's always a remnant.
Yeah, they're breaking, and he's to mark them with an X on their head. And then those who go through and execute judgment are not to touch them, to leave them alone. And, you know, there's a lot in that, but at the moment what I took out of that was that sense of grief and sadness, even a sense of almost like, someone's died, you know, it's a deep, deep agony is appropriate because the times are serious, very serious. So I felt good about, you know, okay, well then what we're going through, this sadness, this compelling sorrow is the heart of God. So I want to move on to the really what I call the big enchiladas as far as these nines, and it's the book of Daniel, chapter 9. And Daniel was one of the great characters in the Old Testament against whom there's no sin recorded, but he lived through the exile to Babylon. And while he got to Babylon, God was able to raise him up into a position to do some good. But he goes to prayer in chapter 9, and he says that he said in verse 3, I turned my face to God, deliberately seeking him by prayer and with pleas of mercy, for with fasting, sackcloth, and ashes. That shows great intent and deliberation in prayer. Oh, Lord, this great and awesome God who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments, we have sinned and done wrong and acted wickedly and rebelled. We've turned aside from your commandments and rules. We have not listened to your servants, the prophets, or the fathers of the church, or the saints, who spoke in your name to our kings, our princes, our fathers, and all the people of the land. To you belongs righteousness, but to us open shame. Devastating, but really true. He doesn't pull punches. He doesn't mince his words. He says, Lord, we have sinned. We have sinned against you. We've pushed your law to the side and refused to obey your voice. We've rejected the commandments. And that whole chapter is a marvelous template of prayer that we can just take before the Lord and go through it and pray with Daniel. We pray for the people of God just like he did. And he says there, while he was speaking and praying and confessing the sin of my people Israel, this is in verse 20, presenting my plea before the Lord my God for the holy hill of my God, which is Jerusalem, he said, then Gabriel appeared to him and said to him, at the very beginning of your pleas for mercy, a word went out, and I have come to tell you, you are greatly loved. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. So to recap that chapter with Daniel, we got to think first, he decisively entered prayer. It wasn't just out of panic or, I feel really bad today, Lord, I need a fix. I need a little bit of God to make me feel better. Nope, that's not what he was there for. He entered prayer for the sake of others and for the glory of God. He set the tone in his prayer of humility, just like Ezra, Nehemiah, the prophets, stating the greatness and the faithfulness and the loving kindness of God. But we have sinned and rebelled. We've been wicked. We've pushed the commandments aside to do our own thing, and this is to us open shame. He makes no excuses. He even admits that in the middle of this great calamity that God promised through Moses, if they weren't faithful, they'd be torn to shred and go into exile. Israel still resisted seeking reconciliation with God. This whole prayer is helpful to our intercession because we have these similar things to deal with. Daniel asked God to remember Jerusalem, the people of God, as it should be, and remember the desolate sanctuary, and to forgive them, and this is good, even though they do not merit compassion, but that the Lord should forgive us so we can glorify his name, so his word can be proclaimed, and so that the sanctuary, which we know what that is, that's our liturgy, that's the Eucharist, that's our place before God in heavenly places, that could be inhabited and God could be glorified again. So we pray decisively, attentively, with humility. We must be contrite, sorrowful for sins, aware of our weaknesses, confessing our sins and the sins of the people. We praise God for his holiness, justice, and compassion, and we ask with a loyal heart like Daniel. Now, what this does is this changes our spiritual position in the world and in the heavenlies. we no longer become somebody tossed around, confused, deluded. What's going on with the church? Is it really the church of God? You know, do we really belong to Jesus? Is he really real? And these are things that are coming at us. No, we end up standing in a place where we are with him. We're certain of what God is doing and what he's doing right now. The more we pray, isn't it weird, guys? The more we pray, the more junk comes out. God is opening up and purifying the church. And some folks think, well, since last summer, the summer of shame, not much has changed. Oh, yes, it has. The whole church is now being spoken the truth about the problem that we have to deal with. Everybody is becoming more aware. You have to almost be deliberately ignorant to not see this stuff. That's right. It's coming out, and God is going to act. It doesn't depend on us. It depends on him, but he wants us to be like spiritual agents or conduits to the world so that we can cooperate with him with our free will and our intercession so he can act.
Yeah.
The end Amen. Of it will be a small church. A faithful church, but small.
Yeah. Hey, Mike, this is Ruben here. It reminds me of that verse in Luke 13:3. It says, no, I say to you, unless you shall do penance, you shall all likewise perish.
Perish.
Right? That's and right. So this is what these prophets of the Old Testament were doing. And in Matthew 11:20, he says that then began he to upbraid the cities where he had done the most of his miracles for that they had not done penance. And this is a sobering right. verse because Christ doesn't work miracles where the people don't repent, and divine power is restricted by human pride. And we see that going on
That's
in the
right.
church. And I think what you're pointing out is fantastic. I've never
it.
Seen this. Yeah.
Good stuff, Mike. Yeah, it's a call to prayer, a call to penance, a call to reparation, a call to fasting, and a call to a private confession, personal confession, and national confession, national repentance.
Right.
Good stuff, Mike.
That's right.
Hey.
Yes, sir.
Yep. Well, I'm so glad what we shared over a cup of coffee, you were able to share this on radio, and we'll have to do this again.
Yeah. We shall. Thanks a lot.
Thank you for being with us, Mike. It gives me something to read at, I want to be reading in adoration. So thank you very much.
Good stuff.
Should be
listening to Jesus Night. Yep. You've been listening to Jesus 911. We had two ride-alongs today, Ruben.
That's right.
We had Rick, a young cop from the state of Utah, and Mike McDonald. He just moved out here to Phoenix, Arizona, out from Wisconsin, and he's another Bible junkie. I love meeting Catholic men who are Bible junkies. There's just so much wisdom to glean from God's Word. Hey, by the way, August 2nd and 3rd, I'm going to be at the Church Militant Men's Conference in Dearborn, Michigan. If you want information, go to Church Militant's website. Or go to my website, jesseromero.com. Also, you can order my new book. It comes out the 29th of this month. It's called The Devil in the City of Angels. You can order it either from 10 or either order from my website. Ruben?
All right. You've been listening to Jesus 911. We had a powerful show. We've got some first responder that is in love with the Lord, and he's serving his community out there doing God's will. And this last talk by Mike McDonald. Amazing. Gives you something to think about. Stay tuned for Jesus, or excuse me, for Hands On Apologetics with Gary Mishuta from the Spiritual Dojo in the Midwest Command Center. Thank you. Here, 10-7.
St. Faustina's Prayer for Priests. Oh my Jesus, I beg thee on behalf of the whole church, grant it love and the light of thy Spirit, and give power to the words of priests, so that hardened hearts might be brought to repentance and return to thee, O Lord. Lord, give us holy priests. Thou thyself maintain them in holiness. O divine and great high priest, may the power of thy mercy accompany them everywhere, and protect them from the devil's traps and snares, which are continually being set for the souls of priests. May the power of thy mercy, O Lord, shatter and bring to naught all that might tarnish the sanctity of priests. For thou canst do all things. Amen. Virgin most powerful, pray for us.